understanding that I had ADHD and that there were a whole bunch of ways that this looks exactly the way it looks like in other people with brains like mine, it said, oh my gosh, there are resources, there's methods, there's strategies to combat this.
Welcome to The Lisa Show, where we take a good look at life. Hey, it's Lisa, and I have a question for you. What is the appropriate amount of time to give others to respond to a group text? Is it 15 minutes? Is it an hour? A week? I'm currently on a thread right now where no one is responding, and I'm wondering how I should be feeling, because right now, I'm on a teeter-totter that's bouncing between amused intrigue and the insecurity of being completely ignored. So here's a shout-out to all of you first responders, both in text emergencies and real emergencies, of course. One of our first responders on social media is Jamie, and she says that as someone who has struggled with depression, our episode with Hank Smith on complete happiness and toxic positivity hit home for you. And so thank you, Jamie, for listening to our show. I really do love it when people are vulnerable and real. It reminds me that I'm not alone in this. Today on The Lisa Show, we're not talking about depression, but something else that touches all of us directly or indirectly, and that's ADHD. According to a recent survey done by the CDC, about 1 in 10 children have ADHD. And I'm looking around the studio right now at the great people I work with, and several of them have ADHD as well. So whether we like it or not, ADHD is in the room, folks. And let me tell you, ADHD is a topic that is deeply personal to me. 3 of my 5 children have a formal diagnosis. Yeah, we've always liked to be overachievers in the Clark household. But as much as I joke about it, it can be frustrating and even painful to have ADHD and then to try to parent someone with ADHD. So this is why I wanted to talk about it today. Am I working through some stuff here? Maybe. But I also figured I would take you along for the ride. Now, I know that the subject of ADHD can spark a lot of differing opinions and philosophies, and I get it. And we're not going to cover all of those today. But what we are going to do today is talk about the benefits of a diagnosis. Then we'll discuss some of the realities of ADHD, including something known as the ADHD tax. We'll tell you what you can do to hack the ADHD system using Bon Jovi. I'll explain that later. And finally, we're going to share some real advice on how to better navigate ADHD as family and friends. I'd like to introduce you to an incredible woman and a dear friend of mine, Becca Hurley Luong. Becca reminds me of a Renaissance painting, if Renaissance paintings had animated eyebrows and a penchant for leather jackets. Becca has been one of my producers for years. She's amazing, and she also happens to have ADHD.
I'm Becca Hurley Luong. I am from Minnesota. I'm 29. I am a producer on the Lisa Shows, and this is the coolest place to work. This is the best.
No, you're so nice. Listen, you have elevated the show. You're an amazing producer, and you're an amazing human. And
guys, do you know how good it feels when Lisa Valentine Clark tells you you're good at stuff? It's great.
Becca makes me laugh, but I also love that she doesn't take herself too seriously. You may already be familiar with her after listening to our episode on phone addiction from a few seasons ago. She's also starred as the energy vampire on some of our social media reels. She really should have gotten an Oscar nomination for those. But Becca is delightful, and she's real, and that's why I knew she was the perfect friend to have on the show to talk about this. Now, we've all heard of ADHD, or attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, and I'm guessing we could all think of someone who fits the hyperactive type of ADHD, you know, the person who can't sit still and blurts out comments. But there's other types of ADHD which may be a little harder to spot. This is why Becca, who is a well-behaved, rule-following people-pleaser, didn't realize she might have ADHD until she was sitting in a college lecture hall.
I was starting to struggle a little bit more with keeping things organized with all my different classes, and I was having the hardest time making it to my classes, keeping track of all my work, and my mental health was starting to really dive. I was isolated, and I was finding myself just staying up really late because I knew I had work to do and I wasn't letting myself go to bed because I had more work to do, but not getting that work done. And I never failed on this level before. I had always managed to pull it out and still get the A. And now, like, I was in danger of failing everything. My whole strategy for handling life just completely broke down. And I remember going to class and I was like, all right, this is it. This is my last chance. I've got to really push myself. I've got to stop daydreaming, or I'm not taking this seriously enough. This is really serious. And I went to a class and I sat in a lecture hall and I just remember I was focusing on the teacher so hard. I was looking at him. I wasn't blinking. And I was gripping the arms of my chair. My knuckles were white. Like, I just, every muscle in my body, I was like, I'm going to hear this lecture. I need to hear this lecture. I'm here. I'm going to do it. And maybe that was the first time that I really became aware that it was like there was a CD skipping. I couldn't hear what he was saying. I could hear the beginning of the sentence and not the end. And that was really scary. You know, this whole time I'd been just kind of punishing myself and saying, this is you not trying hard enough, not taking this seriously, you're coasting, you're being lazy, all of this stuff. And then finally I was in a moment where I could be pretty certain that everything I was capable of doing to focus, I was doing in that moment. And I couldn't hear. I couldn't hear the words.
Becca saw a poster for ADHD and decided to be evaluated. She was given a definitive ADHD diagnosis, and in some ways, it was a relief. She finally had a name for what she'd been experiencing. But in other ways, accepting a diagnosis, especially one with a label like ADHD, can be complicated. In fact, it took Becca a long time to admit her diagnosis. She was afraid of living with the thought of being broken. But eventually, as Becca learned more about ADHD, she realized there were actually a lot of good things about knowing she had the disorder.
There are still some really, really good reasons to get a diagnosis. And one of them is research is coming out all the time, and people are getting really good at identifying some of the aspects of living with ADHD that are tied to this part of your brain and that part of your brain. And having names for some of these things does so much to combat the shame that comes with the struggle of ADHD. There's a few words and phrases that I've picked up that I love. Some of these are more scientific than others. Some of them are just conversational. But things like time blindness or sleep avoidance or rejection sensitivity. Oh man, a lot of people with ADHD experience this. It feels personal. It feels like, oh gosh, I'm not a competent adult. I can't do this. Other people are so good at this and I'm not. And it comes with so much shame. It's terrible. It's not like for a person with ADHD, it's not like you can distinguish in any moment, oh, this was a poor choice that I made of my own volition, or, oh, this is a poor choice that was a function of my brain doesn't process this information that well. It's not like those things are separated out and you don't, you know, you just know that things are harder in general and that you've got less impulse control in general and that your working functional best might be the same as a neurotypical person's working functional best on no sleep.
Two things stand out to me here that I didn't realize until I talked with Becca. First, there's a lot of shame that comes with ADHD as people feel inadequate, imperfect, and not normal. But what also stands out here is that Becca's diagnosis helped alleviate some of her shame for not always being able to do things like other people. Knowledge is power, but knowledge is also belonging. Knowing that she wasn't crazy or incompetent or alone in experiencing her symptoms was a huge step forward in Becca's ADHD journey. Another huge step for Becca was deciding whether or not to go on medication. Now, I know several people who choose to medicate and several who don't. We even have different situations in my own house. Everyone has valid reasons for what they do and methods for coping. Becca held out on taking meds because she was afraid it would change who she was and how God saw her.
I feel like who I am, my personality, included a lot of things where it's like, oh, this is what I've been praised for. I'm creative I'm quick on my feet. And I was really worried that if meds took the edge off this thing that was so hard for me, I was going to lose who I was. And so it was like, well, that's not an option. And I don't even know why I ended up with this pattern of thinking, but the little perfectionistic part of me thought, you know what? If God wanted this to be easier for me, then he wouldn't have made it this way. Like, these meds are an easy way out. I was worried that, like, morally, somehow I was taking a shortcut. So skip ahead. I'm about to fail out of college. This is my last chance. And I decide, well, I guess here I am. And for all the wrong reasons, I finally take my meds the first time. And I remember I'm walking through the library and I feel this immense dread for everything that I have to do start to clear a little bit. And I'm thinking, you know what? Maybe I can start on that paper. And that's where I realized for the first time, oh, actually, maybe this can help me a lot.
Now, before you think this means ADHD meds are a cure-all, they aren't. Becca says they can be a great tool, but you still have to do the work.
What I know now, after years of using different types of meds and sometimes not using meds, is that meds don't do your homework. They don't clean your room. They don't file your taxes. They don't text back your mom. They don't do any of that stuff. And whatever I was so afraid of, they actually cannot make the choices for you, but they actually do give you more of a choice. And I really do believe that God wants me to have choices. For me, it feels like being on a bicycle. And before the meds, I was just in low gear all the time. And I was pedaling really fast. And I couldn't get any traction on this uphill slope. And once I took the meds, that same power that I was applying to pedaling was suddenly moving me upwards.
Medication has given Becca choices and has helped her engage with tasks on a different level by helping her switch gears. But that doesn't mean the ride is always easy. There are several realities that come with ADHD, whether we like it or not, medicated or not. And one of those is what professionals call the ADHD tax. Simply put, the ADHD tax is the additional cost in time and money that people end up paying when they have ADHD.
ADHD tax is one of my favorite things that I've heard people in the community and researchers and psychologists talking about. And it's basically when you forget stuff a lot, it's a little more expensive for you. ADHD tax is, you know what? My landlord doesn't accept automated payments. It drives me crazy.
Oh, no.
I have to do it manually every time. I have to wait for his email. When I get his email, then I can send him the money. And July 4th weekend is right at the beginning of the month. And in this case, he didn't even send us the email until it was July 1st, the day the rent was due. And I had my phone open and I was like, oh, I gotta make sure I handle this today. Oh, you know what else I need to handle? I need to make sure I set up that one account at our bank and da 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 da. And I actually got distracted from paying my rent because I was making a list of the other things I needed to make sure to do that day. And on July 8th, my landlord reaches out and is like, your rent's overdue. You need to pay it with the late fee. And in that moment, oh, the frustration. And it was painful. It was like, oh, no. No. I know I could have done this on time. I've done it on time in the past. Why didn't I handle this? This is the ADHD tax. The ADHD tax is there are things that are going to fall through the cracks that are going to cost you a little more time and money sometimes. And that is a burden, but it's also kind of just a fact of life. It's just going to happen.
You sort of take the morality out of it.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Like, hey, this happens. I'm going to pay it. Oh, still stings.
Yep.
That's the ADHD tax.
No one loves paying taxes, but as the saying goes, they are inevitable. And that is especially true for individuals with ADHD. But I love Becca's attitude about it. Rather than shaming herself for the things that cost her a little more time and money than other people, Becca just plans for it and takes it in stride. The ADHD tax is not an indictment of her ability. It's not a representation of her heart. And it's certainly not a reflection of her character, but it is a reality. And acknowledging it can help loosen that pressure valve of expectation. That's one thing that's helped Becca come to terms with her ADHD. But what you need to know about Becca is that she is part sleuth, part inventor, and part game whiz. She loves to hack a system, and that's exactly what she's done with her ADHD. In fact, Becca has several little tips for surviving ADHD that have made a big difference in her day-to-day life.
I used to make a lot of systems for myself. What I've started to really understand is that all systems are good. Even things that seem like they failed are not failed systems.
Thank you.
And here's what I mean. I think any person with ADHD looks back and sees like a trail of discarded routines and planners and all systems that only worked for 5 minutes. And you know what? They worked for 5 minutes. And that 5 minutes counts for something. You know, if you respond with shame and like, that's a failure, like, oh, I did all that work and I couldn't even stick to it. There I go again. You know, like, Well, then you're never going to want to get back on track, and then you're just going to avoid it. Some of my favorite systems that I've come up with have not been things that lasted a long time. But if you can sustainably allow yourself to try and fail new systems, then that creative problem solving that ADHD people are so good at, which is I'm going to try something new and different, like just give yourself permission to constantly be trying something new and different. Here are some of my like absolute favorite hacks. Or these are the systems I'm using right now. One of the best I ever found, this is for time blindness, was a morning alarm playlist. Listen, every phone can do this now. You can hook it up to Spotify.
I mean, you say playlist and I'm immediately on board.
Oh, Lisa, you're the queen of playlists.
I love them.
You're going to love this.
Okay.
So what you do is like, okay, there's a certain amount of things that you have to do before you can possibly leave the house in the morning.
Yes.
And this might just be me, but morning is the worst time of my day. I wake up feeling like I got hit by a truck because I stayed up too late, inevitably. And now I've got all of these things to do. They have to happen. The stakes are high. I've got to get somewhere. It's just mornings are the worst. And playlists help in a few ways. So instead of just saying, this is what I have to do by this time, you match your tasks to music.
This is amazing.
It really is amazing. It's so good.
Neurotypical.
We should all do this.
It really
works for me. And at the time that I had to implement this, I was struggling. I was working at a school with kids. And so it was like, listen, I got to be there at this time. The kids need me. And I wake up without the will to live most days. And so it started with It's My Life, Bon Jovi. I just needed to tap into that anger. So
I'm already on board.
Oh, yeah.
Super impressed.
If nothing else, then I can wake up thinking, you know what? Nothing's going to take away this opportunity for me to have this day. This day is mine and I'm going to do it. So anyway, so that's where I would start my day. And I would say, when that goes off, I have until the end of the song to get out of bed. So I'll just let it play. I don't even have to open my eyes. I can just enjoy this moment. But I also know, and I've got these constant audible cues that if I don't continue, then I will be late. It cures time blindness because you never don't know what time it is or what you're supposed to be doing or how far along you are in the progress. So then it's like, okay, then there's these three songs for, you know, I just put my phone on the bathroom counter and this is what's going to keep me on track so I don't space out in the shower and wake up 45 minutes later and I've lost the whole thing, right? You do that, whatever it is you need to get done, time it to a playlist, and it's a fun way that keeps you from losing track of time because you will always know. One thing that I've actually started to do recently that has made a huge difference for me is realizing that I can talk about it a little bit more. And the example that I always think of is, you know, you get calls from people. This is just the terrible part about being an adult. Doctors will call you. They'll give you information, and people want to give you verbal information that you cannot handle in the moment. And I've come to understand that I will never get back to that thing. If I don't have it in writing, I'm never going to get back to it. And so when my doctor's office calls me back and when I'm in the car and I can't write it down, I will say, hey, can you send that to me in an email? And sometimes they're like, no, sorry, we don't have that like set up. And I'm like, no, please, I need you to understand. As soon as this call hangs up, I'm going to forget the whole thing and I will not be able to follow up. That's the way my brain works. Can you please help me find a way to get this in writing? And you know what? Nobody does not want to help, like, but you do have to be a little more assertive, and it's totally okay to ask for more help like that.
I respect Becca's honesty with herself. She knows her struggles, and she finds systems that can help, even if she has to change those systems frequently. Side note, I will forever love Becca for choosing Bon Jovi as her wake-up song. Now that's a day started right. Becca's tips of using playlists for time blindness and asking for important information to be written down are all great practical systems that may work for you too. Just remember, it's less about the system and more about the willingness to count your wins where you can and being willing to pivot, reinvent, and even revisit systems as often as necessary. My favorite system of Becca's is actually a phrase she tells herself that helps her to focus on what matters most.
One of my favorite phrases I've been using lately, and this has changed things for me, is that would be nice. And I'll give you an example. Okay, so I was leaving a McDonald's and I'm parked at a stop sign. A car sideswipes me. It's just a fender bender. But I hand the officer my information and he's like, hey, your registration's expired. And I feel guilt and I'm like, oh no, okay, I've got to get my registration handled. I log on to the website and there's like this barrier. I can't use the automatic system because I haven't updated my married name. And now I'm thinking, okay, I need to find the title of my car and I need to go through that system first so that I can update the married name on my thing. So then when I register it, it's under the right name. And this happens to me all of the time. A single task turns into 12, which have to happen in a certain order. And I felt this happening. I was like, okay, I think I'm going to have to let that go. All right, forget the name. I'll change it later. That would be nice. The thing about that would be nice is it allows you to procrastinate in a productive way. This thing that I feel like has to be done before I can do the thing.
It has to, even though no one else is telling you it has to.
It has to be done. I'm going to do that later. I'm going to go through the rest of this process and I'm going to come back and I'm going to do that later. Okay, so I go back to the system and now I'm just trying to get my car registered and I'm due for an emissions check and I have to go get that before I can finish the registration. And at that moment, it offers me a temporary registration. I can have 30 days to get this thing and in the meantime, I'm covered. And it costs something like $6 or like $14. It costs like...
ADHD tax?
That's ADHD tax. That's exactly ADHD tax. Because in that moment, I was like, well, no. I'm just going to go get the emissions check and then I don't have to pay the extra money. And then and it was like, nope. And I clicked, I'm going to do the temporary thing so I can finish this process now. I mean, for a lot of people with ADHD, your most valuable resource is your momentum and you cannot afford to lose it. And so that would be nice is great because these things which are telling you to go backwards instead of forwards, you can say, well, gosh, that would be great. Maybe I'll get to that next. But I'm going to take the imperfect solution right now. So I took the temporary registration. That bought me some time. I went to go get my emissions checked at a place near my house. I actually knew that there was one like about 5 miles away where I could get it done for cheaper. It was like $30 instead of $45. And I thought about that a lot. And then it was like, nope. This is my most valuable resource. Pay the extra $15. That's ADHD tax. Boy, it would be nice. Maybe next year I'll go to the cheaper one. That would be nice. In the meantime, done is better than perfect. I registered my car. I chose the option where they give you the stickers right now. And I actually think even that maybe costs like an extra $3 or $4. But then you don't have to wait for it to come in the mail because I knew, oh gosh, paper mail, that's a subject I can't even get into. And
you're on top of the world.
I'm on top of the world. But it took a lot of, that would be nice.
That would be nice.
And you know what? I got the stickers on my car.
My new favorite phrase, that would be nice. It not only helps free an ADHD brain to do what can and should be done next, but it's a great phrase for every brain. How many times are we overwhelmed and even paralyzed by all the things we want to do? Saying, that would be nice, to some of the things on our lists helps shed unnecessary and impractical expectations. It shuns the shame and allows us to move forward. And some progress is always better than no progress. This is a phrase I will absolutely be using from now on. And it's a start. But, you know, the whole time I was speaking to Becca, I was wondering how I can better support my kids. Becca gave me a tip that I love, and that's to give my kids the choice to opt in to my help or opt out. Here's what that looks like for Becca and her mom.
One thing that we kind of developed over time that's really helped us is, you know, my mom wants to be able to intervene. She wants to be able to say, let me be your buddy. Let me be your accountability partner. Here, I'll just stay on the phone. Why don't you do that piece of homework right now and I'll be right here. And meanwhile, I'm over here going, no, thank you. I don't like that. I don't want that. And at the same time, I'm thinking, oh, I should really take this help. I really need it. Goodness knows I need to get this stuff done. And what we started doing is my mom would ask, like, hey, what hat do you want me to wear right now? Can I manage you? And it gave me the choice to either say yes or no. And being able to opt in made a huge difference for me. Because, you know, sometimes, especially at that point in my life where I didn't have other resources, you know what? The best chance I had was letting my mom help me and letting my mom, you know, step in and do some of that intervention that she was so willing to do. And how lucky am I to have her to do that? And then other times when I knew, like, gosh, if my mom manages me right now, then she's just going to end up so frustrated and I'm going to be so frustrated because I just don't think I can do it. Sometimes I could just say, no, I don't think so. You know what? I think I can handle this, but can I just tell you how I'm feeling right now? And it allowed us to kind of determine, hey, what space are we talking in right now? Is it you're helping me with accountability or is it you're being my sounding board and letting me get all of these feelings off of my chest? And that helped a lot too, because a lot of times actually getting through that was all I really needed to kind of get back in action. And that made such a huge difference for us.
Becca's relationship with her mom has been preserved by Becca's mom asking a simple question. What hat do you want me to wear right now? Do you want me to be your coach, your assistant, or just a listening ear? Note to self, Lisa, you are going to want to help, but you need to give your child the choice to opt in to that help. Got it. I will remember. I know from experience that parents are willing to do anything for their kids, especially when they are struggling. But sometimes we act in our own interest to calm our own insecurities rather than acting in the best interest of our kids. But putting the ball in their court and letting them determine their need, especially if they have ADHD, it preserves our kids' dignity, their independence, and shows them we trust them. Another reason I like this opt-in idea is because it digs at the shame that seems to slither its way into every corner of this issue. People with ADHD aren't helpless, and they certainly aren't hopeless, and respecting their agency and insight just reaffirms that to us as parents and to our kids. Becca's story isn't a unique story, but it's a triumphant one. Becca did get her degree, and then she followed that with a master's degree. But getting to that point meant taking a journey of some very important steps. Becca started with a diagnosis. She took advantage of meds. She now prepares for inevitabilities like ADHD tax. Becca constantly looks for system hacks that work for her, everything from time management playlists to written instructions to using the phrase, "That would be nice." Finally, Becca has made the most of her support network by establishing boundaries and asking for help when needed. When I interviewed Becca, it was with this perspective that she was the one with the struggle and I was the onlooker. However, after speaking with Becca and hearing all of her great ideas, I actually worried that I might have ruined my kids. And when I told her that, Becca took me aside and said that while she didn't want to diminish my concerns, she was worried by my statement. In fact, she explained that in my own way, I was living with the same kind of shame that a person with ADHD feels. When things don't look the way we want, we often internalize it and think, "Wow, it's my fault. I should have known better. I should have done better. I should be better." And the problem for both of us, parents and those living with ADHD alike, is that we often hold ourselves to ideal hypothetical outcomes and overestimate our blame when they don't happen. In the kindest way possible, Becca was helping me see something very important. In our efforts to lift people with ADHD above the stigmas and shame of their disorder, we should also remember to do the same for ourselves, whether we are parents or not. No one is perfect. Ideals are often imaginary. We're all doing our best. God wants to help. And if we're willing to push past the denial and shame that comes with ADHD, there's a beautiful life to be lived for both parents and their kids.
The Lisa Show is a production of BYU Radio, hosted by Lisa Valentine Clark. This episode was produced by Erica Price, with help from Blake Morse, with music and post-production by Kip Merrill. We'd like to thank our guest, Becca Hurley Luong. If you haven't subscribed to The Lisa Show on YouTube, you can find even more content on our channel, including The Council of Moms, filmed live in our studio. As always, thanks for your messages. We read them all, and thanks for listening.
I want to tell you about another incredible show from the BYU Radio family of podcasts, Top of Mind. Top of Mind is perfect for people who want to engage with tough issues that really matter in our communities, but are turned off by how polarizing and divisive these conversations can be. Each week, Top of Mind tackles one tough topic. Award-winning host Julie Rose talks with guests who have complicated perspectives that will challenge you. They're not trying to change your mind, just give you the chance to find more empathy and clarity so you can become a better citizen and a kinder neighbor. Listen to Top of Mind wherever you get your podcasts.